Hi, my name's Hannah Dulson. I'm one of the, there's quite a few musical theatre lecturers at the University of Wolverhampton. My specialism is dance. So I came to musical theatre from a pure dance background. And one of my main areas of interest is the movie musical. So I'm kind of like contextualising what I'm talking about by showing you a little bit of Buster Keaton, because there's nothing wrong with showing you a little bit of Buster Keaton. So the history of the movie musical itself is quite a long one. In a nutshell, what would have happened was you had these kind of black and white silent movies that were accompanied by either a gentleman playing the piano at the front, or a performer playing a piano at the front, and then later on it became kind of like a disc, so a little bit like a record. And over time, these kind of were incorporated together, and what we were left with were the talkies, with the talkie movie, musicals or movies. So just a very, very quick, this is how it went on. So what I'm going to talk to you about today, if I can get my thing, is Gene Kelly, but I'm going to contextualize his work with a little bit of Buster Keaton and Fred Astaire, just so that we can kind of like place him in the context of how he works. So to contextualize it a little bit further, in 1929, as I'm sure quite a few of you are quite aware of, a major financial situation happened in America. And we had what we all know as the Wall Street crash. What happened was that pre the Wall Street crash, America was quite a powerhouse and had been a powerhouse for quite a few years. And post-war meant that a lot of production was being made and a lot of goods were being made. And there was a lot of money in the country. And what happened was they made so many products and so many things that eventually there was no one to buy those things. And what happened was the financial system just crashed, and money, you know, the value of money just decreased incredibly. And this had a real knock-on effect on society and culture within America. It particularly had a real negative effect on Broadway. So as you can imagine, creating theatre is an expensive job. It's an expensive thing. The day-to-day running of a theatre the upkeep of costumes, for the upkeep of venues, for the upkeep of, you know, paying your performers, the amount of money that's needed for that to be successful is more than you probably think. I always have a little moan about the price of tickets for the theatre, but to be able to keep lighting rigs working in working order and costumes on dancers' back, it isn't buying a costume once, it isn't buying a light once. It's the upkeep and the kind of maintenance of that is the thing that's expensive. So if between 1929 and 1930, there was 233 productions on Broadway happening. 1929, Wall Street crash. In 1930 to 31, there was 187. So that number dropped quite considerably in a very short space of time. Within that 10-year period, the number had dropped from 1929 to 1930, 233. In 1939 to 1940, there was 98 productions that were being produced in that year. And the reason being is there just wasn't the income to go to the theatre. It was an expensive thing to do. It was expensive to buy tickets because of the maintenance and the upkeep of theatre. The audiences just couldn't afford to engage that type of entertainment. And what they turned to was the theatre, was the cinema. The reason being, it is expensive to make film, but you're only making it once. And once you've made it, you can then show that movie in as many theatres, as many cinemas as you can. So the money was taken from theatre and put into the movie musical industry. And it was a form of escapism. So the audiences didn't want to see the harsh realities of living in like a post or depression era within America at that time. They wanted to go to the cinema and be able to forget their troubles and forget their worries. There's a there's quite a famous quote which I will pop up here that says there is no other form of entertainment that kind of kept the nation going to that of cinema, that it kind of reflected how people wanted the world to be rather than what the world is. There's that very famous moment in The Wizard of Oz where Dorothy goes into Oz for the first time and goes from a very black and white reality of Kansas into a brightly coloured technicolour of Oz. And that's how the audience wanted it to be. They wanted to walk into a brightly coloured, beautiful world rather than the realities of what they were seeing at home. One of the first gentlemen to really engage with movement on screen was a gentleman called Busley Berkeley. Now, Berkeley wasn't a choreographer. He was never kind of labelled as a choreographer within on the credits. He was always written down as being like a movement captain, because you could argue that really what he got his performers, dancers to do was not dancers we would know as dance, but very pedestrianised movement. So he was born in 1895. And he really revolutionised how the camera was used. He really wanted the audience to have different angles of how movement was shown kind of portrayed in the movie. He didn't want to just see it from that kind of, he was like, right, the camera is an eye, and where can we move that eye to be? So rather than just shooting like you're looking at me now, what is it to look above? What it is to look from the side? What is it to look from below? And he kind of used the camera in a really creative way that maybe had never been used before within cinema. He spent the majority of his career staging dances for the Warner Brothers studio. And he's the three that are the biggest movie musicals that we know are 42nd Street, The Gold Diggers of 1933, and Footlights Parade. If anybody's interested, I know that we have your details and things. I'm very happy to share this PowerPoint with people if needs be. And in on each of these are links to little videos of those kind of performances. But I've got a little video for you to watch just to get like an overview of what his work is like. Thank you. What I really love is that bit at the end, the girl on the, it looks like pianos, I don't know, like the pieces all fit together. It's, I mean, it's obviously quite clear that it's been reversed. And I think it's one of those things that, you know, like for us, when we watch films, like we go, oh, it's just reversed. But I think in those days, I think it's, you have to really think that, you know, this is really exciting. This is something that's never been seen before. And to be able to kind of engage with that and, you know, go to the local cinema and watch this, you know, just really beautiful. And, I mean, it's very stylized of like a lot of beautiful girls are looking very similar, but it's all very kind of like, you know, angles weaving in between performers rather than performers in weaving in between cameras. So the camera's not static, the performers are static, and your camera's what's giving it that kind of movement around, which I think is really, really clear. Really, I think really clear from that clip. So he'd had no dance training. Like, this was not something that he was. He was a director who was a director of movement. And as I say, for me, I kind of go, there's small amount of movement that I would consider to be dance if I wanted to label something as dance. I think things have changed since then. And we look at gestural movement as being, and pedestrianised movement as being dance as well now. But I think at that time, you know, it's no big, massive ballroom number, which I think is probably the comparison. So what he did was he incorporated kind of military precision lines to movement to create patterns, which is why it's important to have those kind of like down shots to see that kind of kaleidoscope of movement. It's always very beautiful girls with big feather fans and big beautiful dresses, and that kind of increase that kind of idea of movement, as in the flow of movement rather than the dance of movement. And he would only use like one camera, and he would then edit it, like move the camera to then create and edit the shot, rather than going, right, I'm going to take three or four different angles of one thing and then edit those together. This one camera will then be the eye of everything. And I think that's really important to make that comparison to that of live theatre, because at that time, movement and stage movement had been in a live theatre that you only have one angle, which is the angle of the audience that are watching. You don't have numerous angle shots. You have this, and this, and this is what your audience sees. And I feel like Berkeley particularly incorporated that in his kind of stylistic quality of, let's keep that essence of the one eye the same in his creation of movement. So as I say, these kind of overhead shots and allowing the camera to move and in and around and through the dancers. And he would kind of focus on one element of the dancer and then open up to kind of have a full body shot. It probably not the most gender balanced comments that you could probably come out with, that he had this idea of like, if you're going to use beautiful girls, why not just let everybody see the beautiful girls? Like, why not use that as a positive rather than a negative? I mean, I think it's probably like a bit of an old fashioned, let's look at girls in their skimpy leotards. Probably not the way forward that would be acceptable nowadays, but I think in those days it was. And he created this kind of two types of numbers. So he would go with like the lavish hundreds of chorus girls. There was that beautiful bit where they were all stood on the ramps with their beautiful feathers. There was the girl at the end with her skirts and the ladies playing the piano. And then the other one was that kind of kaleidoscope, you know, the flowers, that the feathers that then opened up to make flowers, and those circular motifs that he uses. And as I said previously, he was never known as a choreographer. He was a director of dance, a director of movement. And unlike other dance choreographers, he wasn't really interested in dance. He was interested in the visual imagery of movement rather than the visual imagery of a beautiful kick line or a beautiful extension of a dancer. And as I say, he used his dancers as objects for patterns and designs rather than technical danceability. And then bringing us on to the second person. So Berkeley had kind of like created like the stepping stone for other choreographers. And one of the gentlemen that I'm going to focus on today is a gentleman called Fred Astaire. And I'm sure he needs no introduction. He was a dancer, had been born out of a vaudeville performance. He was a vaudeville performer with his sister, and his sister kind of retired and kind of stopped performing. He then developed it into a career, and he was often found on stage. He was often found on screen, and his pairing was that of Ginger Rogers. Everybody knows Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. Throughout the 30s, they created a lot of performances, a lot of films together. He would often play a pauper, someone without any money, and then would perform, and then would pretend to be somebody rich, which of course is what was happening in society in the 30s, that it was that kind of escapism. They say that Astaire gave Ginger Rogers class, and Rogers gave Fred Astaire sex appeal. He always has quite a reputation of being quite a hard worker, to the point of being quite nasty in rehearsals. It's always stated that Fred Astaire was quite a perfectionist, and he didn't like people to get things wrong, and he would work and work and work and make sure that he got it right, and that Ginger Rogers also got it right. So it was always said that he was quite hard to her, but I think he was just a real perfectionist, even within his own work. I don't think he particularly was nasty to her and kind to himself. I think he was equally as critical of his own performance as he was of hers, which I think is important to note, because I always think you hear it from a very one-sided angle. But here's a little bit of Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire.
You know, this reminds me of the old days when we used to give shows in your barn.
Yeah, we used to fight over who handled the gate receipts.
Do you remember the Valentine I sent you, the one with the arrow piercing the heart and dripping blood?
Oh, yeah, I remember that. I think that's the only Valentine I ever received.
The only one I ever sent.
Oh, those were my happy days, weren't they? Mm. You know, I think I was in love with you then, Huck.
I know you were.
You.
Me. What's more, I was madly in love with you.
Oh, we were funny kids, weren't we?
Oh, I suppose so.
Remember that beauty contest I won?
Oh, you got a trip to Kansas City.
Yeah, well, you won it for me. How did you get all those men from the overall factory to vote for me?
That was easy. I showed them a picture of Lillian Russell.
Lillian Russell? Well, what was the matter with my picture?
Well, you must know, we got a lot of votes from the farmers with the picture of a prize heifer.
Oh, you.
Thank you.
So what we get from Fred Astaire is a hybrid of ballroom and tap genres. His tap placement is very, very clear and very, very precise and very quite regimented and parallel, and that's due to the influence of ballroom. So I'm sure probably quite a few of you may watch Strictly, but that kind of in hold, that kind of in position, in hold, gives that kind of idea of everything being very kind of parallel and straight and straightforward. I'm going to just get up and dance because it's probably slightly easier. I'm hoping you can see my feet. So what you get is, I'll put the camera like this. So when he does his time steps, he positions them to like in front of him. So what you get is a backward and forward motion rather than a relaxed out to the side. When we start talking about Gene Kelly, his movement is very different to that. And it really focuses on that technique. And as I said before, like he's always very documented as being quite regimented in his kind of rehearsal process. And the reason being is that it's about the technique, the technique, the technique. I mean, in that clip alone, to get that kind of quality of sound, that kind of question and answer between him and Rogers, that kind of clarity is such a hard thing to do. I am a tapper. I have tapped. And it's something that's just that kind of that sound, that kind of real clean quality, crisp sound. It's really hard to do because you can kind of blag the movement, like my legs go going in the right place, but that quality of sound that he's got is something that can't kind of be blagged in any way. He, as I say, his dance is so crisp and so clean and so precise, and it's all about that kind of like angular kind of, there's no in between, it's here, it's here. And his movement is very similar, like his choreography, his creation of movement is like that, like on like hitting on that beat on that time every time. But he makes it look really effortless. So I always liken it, and it's something that we always say in ballet, that it's like being like a swan. Like your top half is beautiful and elegant and your legs are going like crazy, crazy underneath. And that's exactly him. And ballrooms like that, that kind of upright hold, I'm in position, I'm in hold, but my legs are going like crazy underneath. Is it the like the Viennese waltz when they go straight across the room, and you know, the women have always got their big skirts and cover all that legwork, but the men are, watch Anton de Beck. He's by far, he's crisp, like reminds me just of Fred Astaire, his kind of movement. And as I say, he was a perfectionist and he worked on it for hours and hours and hours. And that's really clear in the work that he produces. He collaborated with a gentleman called Herms Pan, who choreographed a lot of the movement within the films and kind of create that very stylistic quality that he has. And he really wanted to move away from Berkeley. He wanted to move away from that rows and rows of girls and strip it back to a solo choreographer. And what you get is, rather than a camera that works around the dancers, what you get is a camera that shows the whole body. So you get a camera angle that's saying every bit of this performance is important. It's not to do with the visual movement of the dancers from above or winding in between. It's that this every single bit of this dancer is really important. And you have that, I mean, as we show on that example, a big massive open space like you would on the theater, and one camera that's just following the dancers along. So the camera's not really important. It obviously is, but it's not important as the importance of the camera to create movement. The camera is capturing movement, not creating it. And that's the very different stylistic qualities between Berkeley's work and Astaire's work. And as I say, they were kind of full length, full shots. Here I am dancing in the space. And they were, because of this, they were filmed with minimum edits and camera angles. There were big performance spaces that kind of showed that movement, and the camera just went with it in a way of going, I'm just capturing what you're doing, but I'm staying kind of away. I feel like I'm jumping ahead of what I've wrote in my little slides. And it was first, so I could go on about narrative through line of musicals. Is a probably another day's talk that is in itself. So pre-Berkeley, action within a musical would have carried on and then it would have stopped and then you'd have inserted a group of dancing girls who came on and did a dance, and the dance was nothing to do with any of the themes that were being discussed in the musical, then the dancers would go and you would then carry on. At a similar time, Oklahoma was created, which was considered one of the first book musicals, or the first book musical. A book musical is where the singing, the acting and the dancing will continue the plot. And this is exactly the same as Fred Astaire's. So in Fred Astaire's musicals, this idea that movement was of equal importance to the storyline and the songs and the narrative, it was quite equal. So there was no stop of action and here come a group of dancing girls as you would have got in the Berklee musical. But it was a dance to represent an element of the story. It was like a through line and that continued through. And then things started to change and society got a little bit bored of watching the escapism and the kind of non-achievable storylines. You know, you don't go and stay in a hotel and do a dance on the sand within an ashtray and the person below hear you and go, oh, be in my show and we'll make all this money, which I think is slight plot of Top Hat, is that the importance of real life started to come back and people wanted to be able to say, he's like me, that's my performance. And the gentleman who started to do that was Gene Kelly. And his dance style is so different to Fred Astaire's. And again, different to Greg Hines, who was another a performer at that time. And it's the kind of the idea that as cultural differences happened and society continued on and more money was being made and they were going back into a war, and that people wanted that to be represented. And that, as I say, the person who did that was Gene Kelly. I have a bit of a soft spot for Gene Kelly as a performer. So he was born obviously slightly later than the other two gentlemen, and he was really encouraged to do the arts with his family, and him and his brother owned a dancing school, and then he then started on Broadway, because at that point Broadway was kind of like on its way back up, and he kind of made that transition from theatre and the theatre world into that of musical theatre, into film theatre, sorry, and he worked with Busley Berklee. He did lots of performances. I've got a little clip to show you. So this is Kelly himself discussing the importance of training and the importance of choreography. I think he probably will talk about it better than I would talk about it on his behalf. So I'll show you this.
Hiring the American dancer, it has helped him tremendously. In the first place, he must study the classic ballet to gain line and form. He must study the modern dance, a distinctly American product, and he must have a grounding in all the basic movements of the American male. These, of course, are fine in sports. But the greatest factor in changing the look of our dance today has been the emergence as an art form of the American musical comedy. Up until the 30s and 40s, musical comedy was generally a weak imitation of operetta, a collection of pretty girls, comedians, and songs. Well, it was entertaining to be sure, but generally artistically empty. The American musical kept improving until it became a whole new concept. Dancing has not only contributed a great deal to this growth, but has received a great deal from it. For the modern musical demands people with varied talents, people who can sing, dance, and act. The day of the juvenile who carried a tennis racket, chorus boy can only do a time step, that day is gone. But let's stay specifically with the dance. How has it been affected? Well, in a very important way. Now the dancer must play a dramatic role, not be just a specialty act. And in playing this role, he has to stay within the confines of a characterization, a demand that cannot always be met with a specific dance form, such as the classic ballet or the modern dance. Example, Say the role is a truck driver from Pittsburgh. Well, the dancer can't very well step out of a scene he has just played where he says lines like this. Look here, bud, if you want trouble, just stick around, see, you'll get it. The scram! He can't very well say lines like that in a role like this and then step out in front of the audience with arms upraised in classic pose. He can't do it. So this has caused the American dancer to develop a new freestyle of dance, which so far exists in quantity only in this country. It's based on the swing and the beat of our jazz music and on the melodies of our native composers. And it has become as much of a trademark as the hot dog or the Coke. But it's also based on a mixture of the various styles of dancing. We know we need the line of the classic ballet. We know we need its training for precision and control. So we take it and we streamline it to fit the role that the musical play has given us. We use the modern dance for strength and emotional expression. And these, mixed with a movement of sport, gives us what we might call an American style, a freewheeling mixture that fits into our own idiom, a synthesis of old forms and new rhythms. And now, let me see if I can briefly show you how combining all these things, athletic movement, broken line of modern dancing, a long line of the classic ballet, how to develop visually an extension of a character written and dramatized before the dancer got to it. We'll use the music of a composer who wrote in our idiom, George Gershwin. The time, Saturday night. The place, street corner in any American city. Cast of characters.
I'm going to quickly stop it there. I think he said everything I needed to say. I don't think I need to say anything more. I think Gene Kelly's done my job for me. He didn't want to move or act like a rich man. I want to dance in a pair of jeans and I want to dance like the man in the streets. So he wanted to strip back, not technique, as he's explained in that clip, is that technique's important, but he wanted to characterise all of his movement. He wanted his character to be as authentic as it can be in a musical at times, particularly in that era. But he wanted it to be more relaxed and to be more freer and more character-led. And what he did was he combined an athletic style. He combined it with ballet and jazz and the influence of tap. So now I'm going to get up and tap dance for you again. So please excuse my stripy socks I realised I was wearing. So we would have had... So I'm hoping you can see. So the Fred Astaire time step that I was performing earlier would have been in a very, this is a very basic, I should probably do an American time step, is a very basic, straightforward, parallel position. What you get for Gene Kelly is you get a more turned out to the side, relaxed, though I conclude, added a few more beats. So rather than it being this straightforward, very placed position, what you get is a more relaxed style in front of you. And then what happens is that gives it a more authentic realism of movement than I'm being very placed, and the arms would have been a lot looser and it would have been a little bit more grounded, which would have been the more influence of jazz. As I said, lower center of gravity, trying to embody the average Joe than a upright, I'm performing in a ballroom hold that you would have got with a stair. And because of that, he allowed his choreography to rather be centered on one character or a duet. So the Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, Kelly would have allowed the choreography and the movement to have gone with the storyline of the musical. So for example, the Fancy Free would have been a trio of three men. He would have done solos. There's a great snippet, trying to think off the top of my head, the musical where he's on roller skates going down the street with kids. There's a great bit where he does a solo with puts a piece of newspaper on the floor and he rips it and he moves it around with his feet. So he allowed the movement and the choreography and the dances within the musical to be influenced by the character. I mean, obviously they're singing in the rain, but also to not be, I am creating a musical around me. So therefore this partnership is more important than the overall narrative. And he is really overly compared to Fred Astaire, but only in a way of that Fred Astaire was his predecessor and Kelly built his work upon the groundings that Fred Astaire had done, and that they were so different. It was like who's like the most popular. You're either a Fred Astaire person or you're a Gene Kelly person. And as I say, it's more about real life, and it's because America at that time was starting to go back into a time of war, and actually it was more to do with sailors, and it wasn't so much about escapism, it was more about realism at that time. There's a really, so I'm just going to show you lots of little snippets and be like, in this he did this, and in this he did this. So this is from a musical called Anchors Away, which some of you may recognise this clip. It's quite often used in popular culture. Like, I think it's been used in Family Guy, and I think it might have been used in The Simpsons as well. So he was one of the first people to include animation, or was involved in one of the first musicals that used animation, as is Anchors Away. So I'll show you a little tiny clip. Let me just password it. With Jerry the Mouse. Jerry is
an elf, but don't expect to get much help if you don't help yourself. Will you try?
If you show me.
I'll show you.
I'll try.
Good. 1, 2, 3, 4.
1, 2, 3, 4.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
La 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 la.
La 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 la.
You see?
It's easy.
I could just watch him dance all day. The idea of, musical theatre had incorporated and used dream ballets a lot in previous musicals. Gene Kelly was involved in bringing that kind of the idea of the dream ballet. And you can see how quite abstract it is, like how abstract the movement is of the dancers and how abstract the set is. It's like it is a dream sequence. It is that kind of quite traditional dream ballet. So what you don't, like with Gene Kelly's work, is you get quite a multifaceted kind of style of his work. Like, it's appropriate for the musical that he's working on, rather than this, I feel at times, it's not a complaint of Fred Astaire, that it's quite similar, like whether you see a snip from one musical or one musical, but this is kind of like quite abstract, and the performers are like, it's a proper full length, full on ballet. I think it's about 10 minutes long, 15 minutes long towards the end of the piece, rather than in the middle of it, stop the action, do a song, do a dance, as you'd write towards the end. And then obviously the one that we all know and all love is Singing in the Rain.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feel, and I'm happy again. I'm laughing at clouds so dark up above. The sun's in my heart, and I'm ready for love.
Kelly's work has really spanned generations, because I think if I stop and speak to, obviously my students are musical theatre students, so obviously it's a bit of a different audience. But if you speak to students and ask them about Gene Kelly, they know him. And the reason they know him is because of Singing in the Rain. So there was George Samson, who won Britain's Got Talent a few years ago by doing a slightly more modern version of Gene Kelly's of the Singing in the Rain. And then there was an advert a few years ago, last year, year before, I think it was a phone advert, where they edited, they took his face and somebody did some like break dancing kind of hip hop movement, and then he put his face back onto it. So it's quite an iconic, Singing in the Rain in itself is just very, very iconic. And it's that, gentleman in love and happy to sing in the rain about it without a care in the world. So really what you get is a span of three very different artists who really formed the genre of the movie musical, particularly in the early days. And I think that kind of iconic Berkeley style is still used in adverts and in films now. And there's always going to be that kind of traditional ballroom-esque tap dancing that will always be associated with Fred Astaire, and the more grounded every man on the street work of Gene Kelly. I'm going to very quickly just show you this, because you should always finish every session, everywhere, regardless of what you're talking about, with a little duet between Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly. I won't show you all of it, but it's lovely to watch. Let me skip a bit for you.
Fred Astaire, hello.
Hello. I'm sorry, I can't quite place you. What line of business are you in?
Well, I dance.
Oh, at home for the folks, picnics and that kind of thing?
Oh, no, in public.
On street corners?
Oh, no, on the screen, motion pictures.
Oh.
You do go to pictures that have dancing in them, don't you?
Well, I try to see them all. I go
so
often.
Did you see a picture called Cover Girl?
Yes.
Well, who did all the dancing in that?
You're not Rita Hayworth.
No, I'm not, Ginger.
Well, so long, Gene. See you around.
I've got a little number, to do here.
You have?
Sure.
Here?
Sure.
Well, say, why don't we just ad-lib a little something together then, huh?
Whip it up right here in the spot.
Throw it away.
Like the one we've been rehearsing for 2 weeks.
A Babbitt met a bromide on the avenue one day. An elven conversation in their own peculiar way. They both were solid citizens. They both had been around. And as they spoke, you clearly saw their feet were on the ground.
Hello.
How are you?
How's the folks?
What's new?
I'm great.
That's good.